So you may not know this, you may know this, but people are walking around the world today, even in this state, who had a cancer, a deadly cancer, an incurable cancer. They didn't respond to available treatments. They had tried chemotherapy. And yet today, they're walking around with no symptoms of that cancer. Emily Whitehead is one of those people. In fact, she was one of the very first recipients of a type of cell therapy that actually cured her cancer more than 7 years ago. So she's walking around today without the symptoms of cancer because we used her own cells to cure her. And not me, I mean a large community of researchers, engineers, scientists, doctors, and manufacturers to figure out how to make this medicine that used her own immune cells, modified them outside her body, and targeted her specific cancer. That's the promise of cell therapy, but there are many challenges. For example, we cannot cure everyone's cancer, even if they have the same cancer as Emily, with this cell therapy right now. Some people respond and some people don't. We can't cure all cancers with cell therapy right now. She had a blood cancer. Solid tumor cancers are more challenging. And we can't cure all diseases. Even if we develop cell therapies that seem really great in the lab or even tend to cure that disease in the animal, they don't necessarily cure the patient when we move to clinical trials in humans. Now, part of that is the challenge of understanding disease and the variation of disease as we go from person to person. We may have the same disease, but it manifests differently in each of us. But part of that is the variability and our lack of full understanding of how to make living cells into potent and safe medicines. That's the manufacturing challenge. And if we're going to make these kinds of medicines, as promising as they are, into better medicines, we have to learn how to make these kinds of medicines better. We have to innovate on the manufacturing, the processes, the decisions that turn your own living biological material into your own best medicine. And that challenge is manyfold. The challenge of manufacturing cells into medicine includes the challenges of taking the cells outside the body and making them into many cells that can target a particular disease. Part of the reason why these cell therapies are slow to make and costly to make is that they're also very labor intensive. So we don't know how to fully automate the process. And that is common when we're developing a new technology or a new therapy. And that is exactly why we need engineers like me and many others involved in how to streamline this process so it doesn't take so many people so many days, not just because it might make the drug fast and cheaper, but also because it might make it more effective and safer and more reliable for each patient. So as you think about this, the challenges in cell therapy, why do we use cell therapy in the first place versus other medicines we have available to us? Part of it is that when you use cells as medicine, you can actually take advantage of what cells are already good at doing. Cells that actually come from your body are good at targeting and zoning and moving to sites of injury and actually using their own biological processes to repair. This could be the old neurons that you have in your brain, or this could be the cancerous cells that you have in your blood, or this could be the old cartilage cells that you have in your knee. But the idea is that cells can move to those areas, and if we engineer the process or the cells correctly, they can either bind to the bad cells, the disease cells, and kill them, as in the case of cancer, or they can actually become their own drug factories. They can sit in the body and pump out drug molecules that cause the other cells that you have in your body to repair yourself. Or they can even convert into new cell types to replace the damaged cells and tissues. That's a lot of power that biological cells can offer us, but we have to harness it in part through the better ways to manufacture them. So there's two basic kinds of cell therapies. You'll hear about many different types and kinds and a lot of words. Today I'll just share in two classes. The first class of cell therapy we call autologous cell therapy. And that means that the donor and the patient are the exact same person. That's as in Emily's case. So you take the cells out of the donor, you engineer those cells and process those cells outside the body, and then you put them back into that donor. The donor becomes the patient. But then there are other types of cell therapy that we call allogeneic cell therapy. It doesn't tell you what type of cell or what type of disease. What it tells you is that the donor and the patient are different people. And in this kind of cell therapy, the donor could actually donate his or her cells to many different people. So you could become or provide a bank of cells that could treat many different people who have the same disease. With these basic concepts, you can think that, well, the variability in the raw material is quite remarkable. And that variability is really fine if I'm talking about taking different trees in a forest and making customized furniture. The furniture is all going to look a little bit different, but the variability is part of the art, right? It's part of the value. That is not the case when you're trying to use the variable products of your cells or my cells to make a really uniform and potent product for a patient, whether that patient is the same as the donor or different than the donor. So one of the inherent challenges in cell therapy manufacturing is just the variability of the raw product. And you'll see this translate into challenges when we think about how do we turn that variable raw product, your cells, my cells, a bank from your uncle, into a valuable product. Let's go back to this case of autologous cell therapy for cancer. The first step is that you take the cells out of the patient, and specifically you take a class of blood cells, the immune cells, out of the patient, and even more specifically you take the T cells out of the patient. Now, the T cells are supposed to actually find other cells, cells from other foreign objects, and kill them. But the T cells that came from this patient did not have the ability to recognize the cancer cells in that patient as other. They didn't see them as foreign, and so they didn't kill them. But we need to then take those T cells out of the patient and proliferate them or multiply them, increase them into a large number so that we can send them back into the patient as medicine. Because they lacked that ability to actually attack the cancer cells on their own, what we do is we genetically modify those cells using a virus. So these small particles are here to represent a virus. This virus won't make us sick. It won't make those cells sick. It's designed specifically and only to deliver new genetic material to those cells so that they can then behave differently. In this case, they're going to express a specific receptor or protein on the cell surface that's going to allow those new T cells to recognize the cancer cells and bind to them and kill them when we put those modified T cells back into the patient. So that's a very powerful process, but you can see it's a very complex process. If you think about how you would take your own living cells and modify their function, there are several ways to do it. The way that it's done in this particular therapy right now is taking a specific kind of virus that is essentially a Trojan horse. It's going to bring new genetic information into those T cells in the lab and cause those T cells to then express a new protein, a new receptor at the surface. And in that case, that receptor allows now this binding to the cancer cells, the specific cancer cells of interest. So you're changing the DNA of the T cells from the patient in order to actually impart new function. And so that's a modification that itself is very complex. So in order to actually understand the complexity, it's easy to recognize that these medicines are very different than the medicines you're used to taking. And as engineers and manufacturers, it's also very different than the medicines we're used to making. So, for example, when we were making small molecule drugs, or like an aspirin, we were leveraging our deep knowledge, decades and decades of knowledge, on chemistry and chemical engineering. When we were making protein-based therapeutics, also, of course, still made today, or vaccines, we were leveraging our deep knowledge of molecular biology and how to make cells make proteins for us in the lab. But making living cells, making biologics that are our cells as the drug, that has a lot of challenges for us. Let's talk through just a few of those challenges by going after this one example again. These autologous T cells, sometimes called immunotherapy, because we're using our own immune cells to produce the therapy. Sometimes called immuno-oncology, because the immune cells in this case are being used to treat cancer. The first step is to get the T cells from the patient, as you remember. And the challenge is that all of us have different number of T cells of the appropriate type to engineer for this therapy. And we may also have very few of those T cells when we're sick. So getting those cells out and separated is one challenge. Another challenge is that we need those cells to proliferate. But your T cells and my T cells proliferate very differently under very different conditions. And that would mean that we have the potential to, for example, change the manufacturing process for your cells versus my cells. So a variable manufacturing process, a very customized boutique process so that your cells and my cells are processed differently. That's complex, and the goal is to get a lot of cells into that next stage, which is to genetically modify those cells, here using a viral vector or transduction, to express the protein of interest before you put it back into the body. That is a challenge because you also can't sterilize these cells. They're living. If we sterilize them, we actually kill the drug, we kill the function. And so safety is also a challenge. If we could do this perfectly, you would expect that all of the cells that went through that process came out exactly the same. But this remains a challenge, and in fact, it's typical that fewer than half of the cells that go through this viral transduction process actually end up expressing the receptor that's going to then enable those cells to kill your cancer cells. But we deliver all these cells, the ones that express the receptor and the ones that didn't, that sort of got left behind in that process being effective, to the patient. So that's a challenge. We have a variability, and you need the right dosage in order to actually cure your disease. But that other challenge is the safety. As I mentioned, if we can't sterilize the cell product, we have to test that it isn't contaminated, for example, with bacteria, because we're using a lot of raw materials that came from the body in the process. And right now, it takes a couple of weeks to test for bacterial contamination, and it takes a couple of weeks to make the cell product. So there's a lot of pressure on engineering better, faster solutions to test for safety through new technologies, as well as to produce these therapies, because some patients really don't have that kind of time. So one of the ways that we can do this is by leveraging the concept that cells may be slightly different from each other, the good cells and the bad cells. And if we can measure those attributes, what we call the critical quality attributes, the properties that, if I can measure them, correlate with leading to a good therapeutic outcome and curing or benefiting the patient or not. So what if each of the cells were tested through a simple microfluidic device like this one, developed in collaboration with myself and others at MIT and in Singapore, and we would very gently take advantage of the fact that certain cells are different sizes from other cells, and that can depend on their protein expression. So if you can actually gently spiral these cells around, you can separate them on the basis of their size. And if the cells that were correctly engineered are a different size than the rest, then you can collect and put just those cells into the medical vial for the patient and set aside the others. So that's a challenge of identifying a critical quality attribute and then developing a sorting technology to exploit that for the patient. But T cells are not the only cells used for cell therapy, and cancer is not the only indication that is targeted by cell therapy. Another example that you are all walking around with today are stem cells, and you could actually donate today stem cells from your bone marrow. And you could actually use those cells to test for treatment of a variety of conditions. For example, your joint damage or autoimmune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, or diseases like that are related to neurodegeneration that currently have no robust cure, like multiple sclerosis. So a wide range of diseases are under clinical trial and study using stem or stromal cells from your bone marrow. But stem cells can be obtained from other sources, such as your fat or even your skin, because it has been discovered how to convert skin cells into a stem cell-like state. But the challenge of using these cells and the promise of using these cells is that they can be proliferated, and again, my cells can be used to treat multiple patients. But as you see here in this movie, when you multiply these cells outside the body, they're very sensitive to their initial conditions. So you've just watched mesenchymal stromal cells from a human increase in number, but I've colored for you the generation of those cells by different colors. The cooler the colors, the more times the cells have multiplied. And also you can see that the morphology is different. But it's not just the shape and the color of the cells that is different. In fact, the function of the cells is different. And so again, we need to develop new technologies that can benefit from those differences, but then exploit them to produce better processes, to produce better drugs. So the current state of the art right now is to actually expand those cells in the lab or in the manufacturing site and understand that there may be heterogeneity among those cells. Some of the cells may be more effective than others, but those cells are safe and therefore they're delivered to the patient. We can do better if we can measure the attributes of those cells very precisely and use advanced data analytics to correlate the good outcomes with the good cells through all of the properties that we measure. We can develop, for example, sorting technologies like that spiral microfluidic device, separate the good cells from the bad cells, and deliver only the good cells to the patient, for that particular disease. But you can see, even from this picture, that this is inefficient. There's some sorting losses. And so a third approach that I and others are working on is the process development, the feedback loop, the controls, so that you can actually multiply those cells in number without having that inadvertent heterogeneity of the cell population. Get more good cells to proliferate and then deliver those cells to the patient. So it is possible to use cell therapies, to use your own cells or cells of your neighbor or cells of your relative to address really chronic and intractable diseases. We have those successes today. The first two cell-based therapies to treat blood cancers were approved just last year. So we're on the early days of figuring out how to make these very potent medicines work for many different diseases and many different people. And the challenge of that, and my dream, is to develop new technologies and new processes that can enable us to give those cells, the right cells, to the right patient every time. That's not the same as uniform manufacturing. In fact, it will take many new advances in advanced data analytics because we're all different. Our diseases are different, our cells are different, and the manufacturing processes will therefore need to be a little bit different to make sure that all of the cells receive the stamp of approval to go into that person for that disease and produce a positive outcome. But it is possible with the advance of these technologies and with many clinicians and engineers and scientists working together to advance this next class of medicines and, most importantly, to relieve the patient's symptoms while doing no harm. Thank you.